Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
A warm welcome to you and to those who are watching at home. A few announcements before we begin. First of all, as I announced last week, there's a container at the back for the Barnabas Fund Ukrainian appeal. If you haven't already given to it and you would like to get to it this morning, it's there for your use. This will be the last week, and we hope to get that money off to Barnabas Fund ASAP, because obviously there's an urgency to it there. Secondly, Connor Connections and the Mwangi's prayer letter are available on the back table and out on the porch. So please take one on the way out. And then I'm going to ask Andrew to come forward. He's going to bring to us an announcement about a children's Easter event. Thank you.
So you might have noticed in the shops that a few of these are appearing. This is from Louise's secret stash. It has lots of these at home, but it doesn't get out of this particular one. I mean, we wouldn't know Easter's approaching from the weather, but we are hoping that that is the case. And I want to let you know about a special event that's coming up. I could make lots of jokes about extravaganzas and exciting events, but what I want to tell you about is a band, a big Easter hunt. So it's going to take place on Saturday, 16th of April, which is Saturday, 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. We're planning to have it around the church grounds, so we are hoping and praying for some better weather, so do pray for that as well. It's aimed at families of all sorts, for people children up to the age of about 12, but not just for kids. And what we hope and see of this is an opportunity to have some fun, but also as an outreach event, and that allows us to get across some of the message of hope that's at the heart of Easter. We plan to do an Easter hunt, which may have some Easter eggs. There will be chocolate, I think. Egg rolling and painting as well, perhaps some face painting and some other events planned as well. We also have some books to distribute, and that's an important part of the whole event as well. As I say, it's really aimed at outreach. And we want this to be something for the whole church, for the church family and families within our church, but also for people outside the church as well. So it's an opportunity to, I suppose, get in touch with the community and with kids out there who have been missed out quite a lot over the last couple of years. We do need some help with the event, and that's, I suppose, why I'm here as well, because we would like some help, some churches to give us a hand, just with the organisation of things on the day. So if you find yourself feeling you have some time on Saturday, 16th of April, between 11 and 1, please let the ladies and myself know. We'd be very welcome and we'd appreciate the help. So thanks so much, and please do pray for that event as well.
Thank you, Andrew. Let's stand to sing our opening hymn, How Deep the Father's Love. And for those here at home, and that's 224 in the hymn book, How Deep the Father's Love.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Some sentences from Scripture. First of all, from Romans 8 and verse 20 and 21. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. And then in John 4 and verse 24, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Beloved in Christ, we come together to offer to Almighty God our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to confess our sins and to receive God's forgiveness, to hear his holy word proclaimed, to bring before him our needs and the needs of the world, and to pray that in the power of his Spirit we may serve him and know the greatness of his love. Let's take a moment to be quiet before the Lord and to examine our hearts and our lives as we join together in a moment in the confession on screen. We say together, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Merciful God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. Our reading for today is from Joel chapter 2, beginning at verse 18. Then the Lord will be jealous for his land and take pity on his people. The Lord will reply to them, I am sending you grain, new wine and oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive the northern army far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land, with its front columns going into the eastern sea, and those in the rear into the western sea, and its stench will go up, its smell will rise. Surely he has done great things. Be not afraid, O land. Be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. Be not afraid, O wild animals, for the open pastures are becoming green. The trees are bearing their fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, O people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you the autumn rains in righteousness. He sends you abundant showers, both autumn and spring rains as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten, the great locusts and the young locusts, and the other locusts and the locust swarm, my great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full, and you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be ashamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. Here ends our reading. Let us pray. We begin with thanksgiving. Accept, O Lord, our praise and thanks for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the splendour of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. We thank you for the blessing of family and friends, and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We thank you for setting us tasks which demand our best efforts, and for leading us to accomplishments which satisfy and delight us. We thank you also for those disappointments and failures that lead us to acknowledge our dependence on you alone. Above all, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, and for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know him and make him known, and through him at all times and in all places may give thanks to you in all things. Amen. We pray for the many areas of the world where Christians are persecuted today, where Christians know suffering at the hands of others, the many areas of the world where there is war, where there is famine. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us to fear nothing but only him who can hurt the soul. We pray for Christians working in perilous places. We pray that you would prosper their work, uphold them in danger, use them as peacemakers in your service of others, and garrison their hearts and minds with the knowledge that in life or in death, you are with them, their Saviour now and forever. Amen. As we think of Christians working in troubled areas, we think of the Ukraine this morning. Lord, be with the people, the government, and the soldiers fighting for their freedom in Ukraine. We pray for your protection upon them, for your care for the displaced, for your comfort for those who grieve. Father, we pray for peace. We pray for your church in the Ukraine, that it would be a powerful witness in these dark days. Give wisdom to the nations. Protect those nations that border Ukraine from attack. Protect us all from wide-scale war across Europe or even the world. Lord, in this may your will be done. We pray for sense, for repentance to be felt in Russia. We pray that the war would stop. We pray for Mr. Putin, that your justice will be clearly seen. Lord, again, may your will be done. We pray for those who are sick, for those who are suffering at this time. In the silence of our hearts, we name before the Lord those who are personally known to us to be in need of his help at this time. Eternal God, whose Son Jesus Christ bore our griefs and carried our sorrows, and still comes to us in the guise of the needy, hear us as we pray for those in distress, for the hungry and the homeless, for the incapacitated and the handicapped, the mentally afflicted and depressed, the sick and the dying, the aged, the lonely, and the bereaved. Help us, Lord, who offer these prayers, to take the sufferings of others upon ourselves, to remember them before you daily, to be a help to them, and so by your grace to become agents of your transforming love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. As we come to God's word, let me just do one final prayer as we commit ourselves to the Lord as we consider his word. Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you, Lord, for all that it reveals. Lord, speak into our hearts and our lives, Lord, I pray. Lord, help us to see all that you're saying, and help us to live out your word day by day, that you may have all the honour and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I wonder how much you truly value your relationships. Good relationships bring us so much love and blessing and nurture, as well as security in life where we feel safe among those whom we love. But a relationship taken for granted can always be a problem, can't it? We all know that in life, with those whom we love, sometimes issues will arise. Offence may be caused, and relationships are less than they should be as a result. However, in the midst of relationships, one principle holds true: the importance of a little word, the word being sorry. When we know that we have hurt someone, whether it be a word spoken out of turn or an unkind deed, there's a need to put things right as quickly as possible. And it begins, that conversation begins with the word sorry. It's a word, if truly meant, can transform our relationships completely. Well, if that's true in our relationships with one another, it's equally true and more so in our relationship with the Lord. As we live under the covenant, under Jesus Christ, as the people of God. We saw last week the beginnings of this. And now in verses 18 to 27, we see the outworking. Verse 12 to 17 called for repentance among the people. And verse 18 to 27 shows us the Lord's response to a repentant people, a people who have said sorry. As we look at this section, there are two things we need to consider. Firstly, the Lord responds to heartfelt prayer, verses 18 to 20. The context is the prayer of verse 17. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests and the ministers of the Lord weep and say, "Spare your people, O Lord, and make not your heritage a reproach, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God?" The prayer prayed in faith, looking to the Lord, where a people who have genuinely repented is heard, and is a significant turning point that sees the grace of God and the blessing of the Lord poured out upon the land and upon the people. The Lord shows his steadfast love in his jealousy for the land and in his pity for the people. Normally, we think of that word jealousy in terms of the commandment, perhaps, that demands a singular faithfulness to the Lord, whereas in Joel here, it is used in the protective sense of this. This is God's land and he is jealous for it. These are God's people in which for them to live in the land. And so the Lord will intervene to restore the land and to bless his people. In all of that we've seen so far in Joel, the Lord is true to his nature and faithful to the covenant that he has established with his people. This first of all involves judgment, as we've seen. Judgment warned of and judgment carried out. All of which had been foretold by the prophets all along. Some might be tempted to think that that is a thing of the past. But for us today, let us never forget our Lord and our God does not change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so you see that same warning, but a warning with even greater consequence if we ignore the salvation provided for us in Jesus. The Gospels are clear. Jesus is clear. There is a judgment to come. The Lord is true to his nature. Sin will be judged. There will be a day when we will stand before God. So yes, God will judge. But secondly, his nature tells us that he is gracious and merciful and desires to bless people, desires that we should all be saved, which is why he sent his son Jesus to die on a cross for us. The point is, whether we will all be saved or not, because of free will, is a matter of choice. The Lord will not force us. He offers us his salvation. And we must choose. The truth is, some will accept the Lord and his salvation. But sadly, many more will reject. They will reject him. And they will choose the broad road that leads to condemnation. That should sadden our hearts today. It should create an urgency for us to proclaim Jesus all the more. That there are people who are lost. There are people who are facing judgment because of their decisions in life. Well, the reason for judgment and the call for repentance is clear. Verse 18. Then the Lord became jealous for his land and had pity on his people. The Lord yearns for relationship. He wants to know his people, to be with his people. We were created for relationship. You go back to the beginning, back to Genesis, that's what you see. We were created for a relationship. Then later on, the Lord called the people his own as he led them from the land of slavery, from Egypt. And most wonderfully, we were bought at the very great price of the blood of Jesus for this very reason, that we might be in relationship with our Lord and our God, that the barrier of sin might be removed so that we can know the Lord without hindrance. The way to God is open. The Lord has made it open in his grace and in his mercy to you today. So the Lord blesses the land that was brought under judgment by the army of locusts and the fire that devoured everything, as we saw in chapter 1. What we see in this blessing is the renewed fruitfulness and the restored reputation and the invaders repelled. The locusts had eaten everything. Remember in chapter 1 and verse 9, it says there was nothing left to offer the Lord. The grain offering and the drink offering are cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests mourn and the ministers of the Lord. And now in chapter 2 verse 19 it says, behold, I am sending you grain and wine and oil, and you will be satisfied. And no more will I make you a reproach among the nations. The land is fruitful once more. It is no longer a talking point for the nations around them. Their reputation is restored. And as verse 20 tells us, the invaders are repelled. It is clear from what is said that the locusts were not a one-off. They came back year after year. But now, in his grace and in his mercy, the Lord deals with them as they are driven into the sea. So just as the Lord responds to the prayer of repentance and restores fruitfulness to the land, so secondly, we see that the people and their response is to enjoy the blessings renewed and to be enjoyed. Verse 21 to 27. Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things. Fear not, you beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness are green. The tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and the vine give their full yield. Be glad, O children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given the early rain for your vindication. He has poured down for you abundant rain, the early and the latter rain as before. The threshing floors shall be full of grain. The vats shall overflow with wine and oil. You see, the weeping is replaced by the Lord's blessing. We see it in the land in verse 21 and 22, and in the children of God in verse 23 to 27. As Joel says in verse 21b, for the Lord has done great things. And so you see joy expressed with the instruction to be glad and to rejoice. Because of covenant unfaithfulness of a wayward people, the land had been devastated under judgment. But now the creation can rejoice because of a restored fruitfulness. The wilderness created by the locusts and the fire is now a green pasture. The animals that were in anguish because of the condition of the land and the lack of water need no longer fear. The fruit trees bear their fruit once more. As the land is blessed in restoration, so too in verse 23 and 27, the people of Zion, God's children in Judah, are called to rejoice because of what the Lord is doing among them in the nature. This revolves around rains. Rains that have been absent. Verse 23, be glad, O children of Zion, and rejoice, for the Lord your God has given you the early rain for your vindication. So there's an abundance. Because of the rain, there is an abundance of provision through grain and wine and oil. In the midst of the restoration, we see the crux of the judgment in verse 25, which is an important verse in the whole book of Joel. I will restore you the years that the swarming locusts have eaten, the hopper, the destroyer, the cutter, my great army, which I sent among you. Notice those words, as the locusts are spoken of, my great army. Confirmation explicitly stated that the Lord himself sent the locusts as a judgment upon the people because of their unfaithfulness and their disobedience. It may well have been shocking to their ears, and indeed for a people today who aren't taking the word of God seriously. You aren't hearing what's been said. Equally though, just as it may have been a shock, so too there's an encouragement. Because the swarming locusts have a cost to pay too. As the Lord restores the lost years, it's a reminder to us that the invaders are instruments, yes, of judgment, but are equally responsible for their actions before the Lord. There's a day of reckoning for all. As we stand before the Lord in all that we have done in this life, no one will escape. No matter how it appears to us here and now, there will be a reckoning where we will answer for our lives and for what we have done with the Lord's provision for us in Jesus. So as Joel tells it, as it is for the people of Zion, yes, they have been judged by the Lord, but now There's a time of rejoicing, a restoration and blessing. And so they are encouraged to praise the Lord their God. It is a praise coming from a people who know the Lord's provision as they eat, who are restored in their worship and seek to honour the Lord because they are a people who know the Lord, who were previously disobedient and did not know the Lord. They had been far away and now they're brought near through the Lord's provision, through the Lord's blessing. It says in verse 26 and 27, "You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you. And my people shall never again be put to shame. You shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and there is none else. And my people shall never again be put to shame. The Lord has dealt with them wondrously in all that he has done. Their praise marvels at his actions of their God, who has loved them with justice and restored them by his intervention and provided for them with an abundance." The point being in his revelation reminded of here, where he says, I am the Lord your God, and there's none else. For a while, for a long while perhaps, they had forgotten this fact. Their God is the only true God. Their God is loving and gracious and deserves their praise and adoration because there is none other worthy. If they knew that then, how much more can we see the I Am, who is the Lord, who sent his only begotten Son, Jesus, to provide for us in his grace and abundance the salvation available to you because of the death and resurrection of Jesus, says clearly there is no other worthy of our praise, because he is God, his word is true, and our hope is in him alone. We will never be put to shame as we trust in Jesus. He has stood in our shoes. He is our sacrifice. And we praise God by saying he has done all things well. The question I leave with you this morning is, have you seen it for yourself? And is your life one which praises the Lord, who is your God, because there is no other? Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that you are the Lord our God. We trust in you alone because of who you are and because of all that you have done for us in your Son Jesus. May our lives, as well as our lips, praise you and honour you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand to sing our final hymn this morning. Saviour, send a blessing to us. And that's number 339 for those who are at home. Saviour, send a blessing to us.
Thank you.
God be with you in your going out and your coming in. God be with you in your work and in your leisure. God be with you in life's hills and in its valleys. God be with you in company and in solitude. God be with you in all your pilgrimage and at its end. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit abide with you always. Amen. Amen. Please be seated and await to be directed to leave by one of the wardens. Thank you.